even though the plan based on f5 is the most logical strategically, if you talk about pawn play, and it's also quite promising, we should take a few details into account. First of all, this requires some efforts from white. It's not so simple to play f5. We have to prepare it with g4, knight g3. We have to sustain the pawn's advance in a way or another. And this means that we may neglect development for it. For instance, we could have the king still in the center. And this can be really double-edged if we think that black also has his play based on his pressure on d4 or opening the c-file for his rook. The second question is what to do after we play f5. Of course, optically it looks very impressive. Black feels under some pressure, as if the ceiling was really narrow for really low for him. But still, white should continue somehow. And I'll here highlight a few possible plans after f5. One of them would be increasing the pressure on e6 with g3, followed by bishop h3. The other one would be bishop d3 in order to target the king side, and after an exchange on e6 to attack h7, sometimes even sacrifices on h7 are possible. We could also think of widening the area of the attack with h4, and if h6 is a move which is frequently played, then we can just clear some space for our pieces with f takes e6 and h5. And now we have the g6 square for the knight, and we have some other some more room which was not available before we played the f5 and f takes e6. So this is another possible plan. And finally, the most threatening of all is f6. f6, which is actually also double-edged. After an exchange here, we can see that there is a permanent danger of mate on g7. Of course, if black has castled short. But anyway, f6 is some sort of nasty pawn which restricts black's minor pieces. On the other hand, there is this possibility of breaking with e5, which can be especially dangerous if the king is on e1. So these are, in short, white's possible ways of continuing his attack after f5. And now we'll see a few typical situations. This is the game Grishuk Najdic. White has sacrificed a pawn in order to the a pawn in order to clear the a3 square for his bishop, which is cutting like a blade. And he also has prepared a powerful attack on the king side. He still needs playing f5. As we see, f5 would mainly aim at taking on e6 and clearing the g6 square for the knight. Because if f6, then black can simply take, and because the rook is protected, and this would open the g-file for the rook, with counterplay against the relatively weak g3 pawn. So the question is if white should play f5 at once or still prepare it. In the game, Grishuk opted for the latter. Actually, f5 was entirely possible already. He probably disliked the idea of knight takes f5. Takes, takes. And now, a typical moment. If white takes on f5, then black simply exchanges. Then he plays king c7 and prepares the knight transfer to e6. We'll see this theme in later examples in another chapter. After the knight blocks on e6, black is doing fine, and he still has this extra pawn on the king side, queen side. He can prepare playing b4. But here white has a better move, which is queen f4. And this would keep his attack going. The threat is bishop takes f5, and it is already not so simple to block on e6. And if g6 then, or g5, then after taking the h6 pawn would be hanging. One way or another, Grishuk played rook b1, which also makes some sense because it keeps black's queenside under some pressure. Actually, there is an immediate threat to take on e7 and then take on a4. This just wins a piece because the rook is hanging on b6. And now it's a good question for black how to react. He also has to keep the balance between both wings. As I said, the position is very, very complicated. I believe the best thing he could have done was king c7. It defends the rook on b6. And if f5, then he can go knight d8. This not only over defends e6, but at some later stage he can already think of taking on f5 and then play knight e6. And this would ensure him some stability. We know about this already. Nadic played more ambitiously b4, but actually this is leading to trouble. B4, c takes b4, knight c6. The pawn is pinned because the b1 rook is hanging. But after knight c6, f5 is very strong. Suddenly the knight obstructs the rook, so e6 is really hanging now. Taking on f5 is out of question because white can simply take with the knight and black cannot exchange it anymore. This would be a very strong pressure. So knight takes b4 is forced now. If ab, the bishop is actually not attacked because the rook is hanging. So white has many good moves here, but the simplest one would be just taking here and just take the pawn. White has retrieved the pawn, and now black has the weaknesses on d5 mainly, but also on g7 because the knight would come to f5. And white would surely be much better. Knight b4 is more principled because it defends e6. But now a curious forced line arises. Takes c3. The knight is pinned, so bishop b3 is the best. If knight takes a2, rook takes here. Let's say knight takes e3, rook takes e6. And this is a huge attack. Actually, now the threat is rook d6. Followed by rook d6 is not yet, sorry. The queen has to move away, and then there would be threats. I overlooked that the queen is defended by the a4 bishop. But anyway, it's clear that white has achieved his first aim to destroy black's pawn chain. So knight played bishop b3. This looks like a systematic invasion of the queen side. But this allows a very quick switch to the king side, rook f2. Now the knight is hanging, knight d3. Again, systematical, the whole queen side is dominated by black. But now, suddenly rook f6 makes things quite clear. The rook is taboo because the g8 rook is hanging. And black cannot defend his weaknesses anymore. If rook e8, then just rook g6. We see how white uses the space created by this exchange on e6. This is an idea I have mentioned. First, he invaded along the f-file, and now he uses the g6 square. Knight h played king c7, but now this was just a positional crash. He has to defend d5, knight f5. With red, I have marked all the squares controlled by the white pieces, which create some sort of barrier. Black is partly paralyzed. The knight on b7 doesn't have any moves. And the d5 and g7 pawns are very weak. And the bishop on a3 is still very, very strong. So white won, it's a little wonder about that. So we saw a perfect illustration of the exchange on e6, and also some minor details regarding the connection between the wings. Let's move to another example. This is one of my games against Guliev. I was playing black, and actually I had done everything all right until this moment. But now I started hallucinating. We see that White's attack looks quite promising. He not only played f5, but also has some active pieces, the queen, for instance. And his main threat is taking on e6 and then playing queen g6, once again clearing space for the queen. When suddenly, because of the bishop on e7, there is no clear way how to defend the g7 pawn. And of course, the threat is simple, and pairing it is less so. During the game, I considered c takes d4, which is probably second best, and bishop c5. I want to exchange this knight before white gets to play f takes e6 and queen g6. I could react with bishop takes d4. But now that the bishop has moved away, white can switch to the B plan, which is f6. And now black simply loses his h6 pawn. But actually, this I saw, black is not doing so badly here. The pawn on e5 is kind of hanging. I have the plan king b8 and rook c8. This would be a playable position. Maybe slightly worse, but still playable. And yet, in the initial position here, there was a simple solution. The only thing is to find a good square for the bishop in order to parry f takes e6 and queen g6 with a bishop move. And the way to do it was c4. Actually, I saw some of the lines in a flash, but I cannot explain what happened that I didn't play it. If b takes e4, then knight a5, and suddenly black has a very strong attack. White has to worry about his king. f6 is not so effective now with the bishop on e7 still, because it leads to just an exchange of pawns with no real advantage for white. Actually, black has very good chances on the queen side. Also, after knight f4, black can just play a consolidating move like king b7, because after the exchange on e6, the knight on f4 is hanging. So white has no time for queen g6. So we see that actually things are not so simple for white. Finally, if he takes here, then I said queen g6 and now bishop a3. And now knight f4 is not available. Black will little by little create some threats on the queen side. And for white, it's not so clear what to do further. Well, in the game, I played king b8, which is not the best. And now I had this problem. White has carried out his plan in optimal form. He has cleared space for the queen. And now he threatens to take a pawn. And, well, what I did now is completely suicide. I don't even remember what I had calculated. I took here knight xd4 and I just lost the pawn on e6. I somehow thought I get some sort of compensation, but this was an illusion. Actually, even now c4 was reasonable. Of course, white wins two pawns, but black still has some counterplay. So even this would have been better than the game. So even though this game ended in a disaster, after c4 and bishop a3, we can understand that white's play was not so simple to continue after the exchange on e6. Because black is also well placed, the rook is controlling the f-file, so black can have antidotes to such a simple plan. Let's now move to the second possibility. The second main plan, which is f6. If we look at the position, I understand that strategically black is not doing so badly. He has exchanged the light square bishops, so there is no danger in the end game. He has no passive pieces anymore. And actually, if he was to move, he would just take on f5, and then the rook would be very active along the sixth rank. So if white takes on e6, then f takes e6 is the simplest, but rook takes e6 is also good. So white does not have much of a choice. And he played f6, which is actually quite a strong move. Gf e4, and now bishop h6. Actually, in the initial position, white was not completely developed, but now he develops a piece quite actively. And this move at least wins an exchange, because after rook e8, there are several combinations possible. The most spectacular is knight g5. Threatens mate on h7. If black takes, then rook takes f7, a typical combination. Knight f8 to defend. The rook was taboo because of mate on h7. That's clear. Knight f8 takes. King takes. Now there is this square available for the king, but not for too long. Rook here and white wins. Also, if f5, then queen g3. Threatens knight somewhere, for instance, on e6. If the king moves to h8, then knight f7 mate. And if he takes, then takes, followed by bishop f6, winning. Actually, white could do it also simpler. He takes f6, bishop takes f6, and now knight e5. If bishop e5, then again rook takes f7, and it's similar to the previous combination. So black rightly decided to sacrifice the exchange, f takes e5. His main idea was that if white takes, then black achieves some compensation. He has a pawn. His king is relatively safe by now. The e5 pawn is a permanent, it's a chronical weakness already. White needs to defend it permanently. And black can then defend the c file with rook c6. Probably he's slightly worse, but in principle this would be not so convincing from white's point of view. And white kept the tension. Knight takes e5, knight takes, d takes. Now the threat is queen g3. And black doesn't have good defenses already. If he goes king h8, then bishop takes f8 is a lot different. First of all, f7 is hanging, so black needs to place his queen on a passive square. Rook ac1 threatens rook c7 with very strong pressure. If rook b7, then queen a6. In all these positions, white is close to winning. f5 is also an interesting try, but once again, white should not hurry with taking on f8, even though this still would be good. He can do better by continuing his attack. Now he retrieves the pawn, and actually for black it would be best to leave the exchange, the rook on f8, but okay, of course this would be losing. If rook f7, then just queen here and rook ac1. And black is very, very passive, and white simply prepares attacking with simple moves. Rook c5, rook fc1. It's basically winning. Black tried defending with two apparently active moves, queen h4. And now takes and takes. Now he was probably hoping to reach that kind of positions which we saw with the bishop on g7, but the queen doesn't stand well on h4. Actually, it would turn a loss of time. Rook ac1. It threatens to intrude along the d file. If rook b8, then rook c7, and f7 is a problem. So queen d8, and now it seems that black is just one step away from bishop g7. Of course, this would still be worse than what we saw, because white already controls the c-file. So this is already not so good, but white has a forced win already. Rook takes f7, we know the trick. Takes, check, and rook c7. And now there was only one way to parry the threat queen f7, namely this. White took the queen after giving some checks. Of course, taking immediately is also winning, and he won some moves later. We should not think that f6 can be connected only with, let's say, a very energetic attack. F6 can also have some strategical meaning, which is the case in this game. There are no queens on board, so we can understand that the attack cannot have the same character. If we look at the bishop on h3, we can understand that at some point it will put pressure on e6. And speaking about bishops, here the other bishops have been exchanged, which already favors white, because black still has the bad bishop on b7. Actually, in this game, it will be really spectator. And even though, yes, f takes e6 now is not so convincing, because as in my game, it would open the f file for the black rook, and knight f4 is not so easy to carry out. But f6 is very, very strong. Black needs to take, because if knight c6, for instance, then g5. White wants to open the king's position, and the black is not in time to block it properly. For instance, if h5, knight here, g6, there is such a small... I cannot even call it combination, because this is not a sacrifice. White has two pawns and a rook for two minor pieces. The pawns are very, very advanced, and the black's minor piece is very passive, so this is just winning. So black took, and his idea was that now his knight has a free access to e4, but actually that's not so molesting for white, because the knight alone cannot create threats. It can only give a check. While white has this move, knight e5, which is a perfect blocking move, it controls everything around the f6 pawn, and it also contributes to the final attack. Even though there is not so much material on board, such a pawn on f6 can ensure a very, very strong attack. Knight e5, rook c8, rook g1, check, king f8. It anticipates g6 when the king and the rook would stand on the fork, bishop e6. And now rook h1. The threat is bishop takes e6, followed by rook h8 mate. And actually, black doesn't have good defenses already. He played, well, for instance, if king g8, then g6. Knight takes here, takes. King f8, bishop takes e6. And now knight g6 or rook g1, rook g8. The pawn is too strong. White wins quickly. He tried rook c2, with the idea of rook takes c2 and knight g3. And actually, white could still have played his plan bishop takes e6, because tactics don't work out well for black, rook takes e2. Well, first of all, we have to understand that white needs to take on e2, because if he moves away with the king, there would be just a perpetual. Rook g2. And of course, the king cannot go on the h-file, because this would allow f takes e6. So it would be a draw. But fortunately, he has a knight, a king takes here. This. Now the knight on h1 is not an extra piece. It's trapped. White can win it at any moment. Actually, he can continue. Of course, bishop takes f7 is winning, but he can also play g6. This wins quicker. Knight g4 and knight h6, and the pawn promotes. In the game, maybe he was right not to enter this line. He played bishop g4, it defends on e2, and threatens mate mate e1. We can see that the knight and pawn, they cooperate perfectly. They have this, create this barrier, so the king cannot escape through e8. So he had to go back to g8, and now g6. So, and black simply resigned. Even though bishop takes e6 would have been more beautiful, from a practical point of view, you don't need. Bishop g4 is convincing enough. g6, and now there are no defenses. If f takes g6, then the king returns to the mating box. Or if knight f6, then takes. Bishop takes e6, and again, rook g1, rook g8. The pawn is far too strong. In all these examples, it has been relatively clear what white had to do, f takes e6 or f6, even though there were some possible change of plans. So the main threat being f takes e6, but f6 being a reserve move. But sometimes one needs a very clear understanding of the position to make the right choice. We have the game Vokaturo Johannesson. White is not so well developed now, but Black also needs some time to develop his queenside. So the position is not very clear. Of course, White has consolidated his space advantage. D4 is very well defended. And he played F5. Actually, now is a good moment to talk about, it's like some sort of connection with the next chapter. Black didn't take on, or he continued his plan with Bishop B4, which makes some sense. Actually, he takes F5 is always a possibility. Obviously, White wanted to go Knight F4, because there is no way to defend D5. But in this position, maybe he doesn't have to take now. Maybe he has to play h4 to play for compensation. Bishop d3, h4. Because if he takes, then it suddenly appears that he's not so well developed. His king in the center. Now Black would like to play rook d8 and the bishop e6 to block the center. And if the center advances, then it's also not so clear. Black may break with f6 at some point, and with the king in the center, things are anything but clear. Black played bishop b4. He just wants to increase. We'll see. He has a very clear plan of increasing the pressure on c3. And now the game went knight f4. White was playing for f6, knight f4. The main problem with knight f4 is that it doesn't contribute too much to development. And it weakens the defense on c3, and Black can immediately take advantage of it. Queen here, knight b6. And now the plan is bishop d7, rook c8, knight a4. White is under some pressure, and actually White had played all this because he planned f6, which we know it's one of the main themes. Still, f6 is not so effective now, because after the exchange, well, the king is in the center, and now the best thing Black could do was, well, the king is the center, and the queen is far from the king side. There is no immediate threat of queen somewhere on the g5, g5, g3. So Black enjoys some safety now, and he could have just played knight d7, and if knight h5 defending the pawn, then e5, and suddenly things are not so clear. Of course, the Black has to be careful with his king, but White's king is also not so safe. But in the game, he was kind of impatient. He played e5, and after d takes e5, he eventually retrieved the pawn. It's not easy to do it at once, but he still got the worst position. So this plan based on f6 was not the best here. And if we return to this moment, it would have been better to just release the tension, because actually the tension was some source of worries for White. Okay, he played f5 and Black didn't take on f5, but he could do it on the next move. So we are not developed. Our king is still in the center, we still need a few tempi to... So take here and queen d2. Just develop. And at the same time defend the bishop on c3. And now let's first see what happens if Black plays in the same way as in the game, queen a5, because he has to clear squares for the d7 knight, otherwise his bishop would be just immobile on c8. Knight g3, knight b6, bishop d3. And now on the next move, Black should probably play knight c4, which is actually some sort of concession, because now he loses some control in the center, and he's not in time to block on d5 properly. For instance, here, this is the typical situation where f takes e6 has cleared some space for White's pieces. Bishop e8. The threat was queen g5, so bishop e8 is more or less forced. Knight here, bishop f7, knight here. Defends the pawn, queen here, threatens mate, g6, knight h5, and White is obviously winning. So you see that by simply developing after taking on e6, White would could have got a strong pressure. Oh, let's see what happens if this is funny, actually. What happens if Black doesn't play knight c4 and just, let's say, develops normally. Now the attacking field is all whites, and he can already deliver this typical combination. We'll see more about it. Takes knight g5. Now if king g8, then queen d3, threatens mate, rook f5, the only move. Now we see why white needed to castle before taking on h7. He needed his pieces to be in play. His queen's rook can also join the battle, but more or less white is mating on h7 soon. Or if king g6, then a possible continuation is queen e2, threatens mate on h5, rook here, and now engines indicate knight h7 as the fastest win, but I believe that the normal knight f7 is also good enough. They can see that the king is the threat is queen queen g4 and or queen d3. So black can do very little to parry this attack. Probably in this position, black should play more cautiously with rook e8 to clear another square for the knight, like this. White, of course, has a lot of pressure here, but at least h7 is defended, and it's not so simple yet to deliver this, the decisive blow. But still, this would be a very good position for white, obviously. So we saw now more or less what are the basic plans after f5 for white. In the next video, we'll see what black would think up strategically to cross white's intentions.